Good morning and welcome to a new series of daily devotions. These ones are with me, Daf Marion Jones. And we're going to be looking at a letter in the New Testament, Paul's letter to a young church leader, Titus. He's on the island of Crete, and Paul's left him there to sort out the local church. You'll find Titus in the T's that are towards the end of your New Testament, when you get to his letters to 1 and 2 Thessalonians, 1 and 2 Timothy, and then you come to Titus. I'm just going to read the first three verses this morning. Titus chapter 1, verses 1 to 3. Paul, a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, for the faith of God's elect and the knowledge of the truth that leads to godliness, a faith and knowledge resting on the hope of eternal life, which God, who does not lie, promised before the beginning of time. That is appointed season. He brought his word to light through the preaching entrusted to me by the command of God our Saviour. What we believe affects the way we behave. Oh, we're seeing that, aren't we, amongst our Muslim friends at the moment. During this season of Ramadan, they're fasting during the hours of daylight. And the centre of the message that Paul has for Titus to convey to the churches in Crete is what you believe really matters, and it should change the way that you behave. I find that in my daily life, that what I believe changes the way I behave. For instance, I'm pretty sure that my wife Boo is not a homicidal maniac, and therefore I safely sleep beside her every night in a reasonably calm way. What we believe affects the way we behave. And in Titus, Paul outlines the beautiful news about the Lord Jesus, that which Christians believe. He talks about the grace of God, the undeserved loving kindness that we've received in Jesus. He talks about the way that Jesus has come to purify us through his death at the cross. He talks about the giving of God's Holy Spirit to bring us to a new birth, a fresh start with God. All of those things should change, he says, the way we behave. Not in terms of religious ritual or in terms necessarily of fasting, but rather in the terms primarily of the way we treat one another, in the way that we love God and we love other people. Be those within marriage relationships, be those who are inside or outside the church, be even those that the governing authorities and how we should respond to them. What we believe about Jesus should change the way we behave. That's why he says, it's a knowledge of the truth that leads to godliness. In fact, just in these opening three verses, there are a couple of precious truths that should change the way we behave even today. I wonder if you noticed in verse 1, he describes Christians as God's elect, God's chosen people. We were thinking recently on a Sunday morning about how we find security and how in our society, security comes from your identity within yourself, who you are and who you feel you are now. Therefore, the way other people treat you, it can build you up, but it can also leave you feeling desperately low and isolated. But if you're one of God's elect, God's chosen people, a son or daughter of the living God simply because he has set his love on you, well then today, the way other people treat you need not rock your self-confidence, because your confidence isn't in who you are or what they think of you, but it's in the fact that you have a loving Heavenly Father who's chosen you and has promised never to let you go. Or what about in verse 2, he talks about the hope of eternal life, which God, who does not lie, promised before the beginning of time. You see, God's got a 100% success rate on keeping all of his promises. So if he says to you, you have eternal life, then you do. The word hope in the New Testament doesn't mean, I hope it doesn't rain this afternoon because we've got to eat outside with friends this evening. No, hope is something that's certain in the future that we haven't yet got. Certain, though, because God promised it and he doesn't lie. We know that, of course, because we know that Jesus died and rose again and secured us eternal life. And of course, if we're certain about our future beyond death, then, well, the way we respond to the fear of COVID will be different. The way we respond to old age will be different. We'll be those who have a tangible peace in face of things that other people around us are desperately afraid of. See, there are two wonderful truths that change our godliness, the way we live day by day, the way we treat one another. It's the knowledge of the truth that leads to godliness. And how are we to therefore find that truth? Well, Paul begins to hint at it in verse 3. He talks about God's word that's come to light through the preaching entrusted to Paul by the command of God his Saviour. It's as we come back to God's word in the Bible time and time again, we find the beautiful truth about Jesus, and that then changes our hearts to be more and more like him each day. You see, we're going to see in Titus that actually only coming to the gospel of grace will enable us to be gracious and loving people. So all we need today, a knowledge of the truth from God's word about who we are and what he's done for us in Christ. And that way, we'll begin to live lives that are a little bit more like those of our precious Saviour. Let me pray. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the truth of the gospel contained within your word, that beautiful message of salvation, of grace, of your undeserved loving kindness, of who we are, God's chosen, precious children, of what we look forward to, that hope of certain eternal life. Please, would those truths today change how we feel about ourselves, how we treat other people around us, and how we feel about the future. Father, today, through your beautiful gospel, make us a little bit more like Jesus by the power of your Spirit, for his name's sake. Amen. Well, it's great, isn't it, to have a daily devotion with the sound of the kite overhead in the garden, the glories of Gerard's Cross in the springtime. I'll see you tomorrow.